Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight we're going to start with this. Well, that was P.F. Sloan doing his 1965 song, Eve of Destruction. No, we're not doing P.F. Sloan tonight. We've already done his podcast. I refer you to it. We're doing Birch Bayh, who died recently at the age of 91. Birch Bayh was a three-term senator out of Indiana from 1962 to 1980. And what's the relationship between him and P.F. Sloan? It's that line in the song, you're old enough to kill, but not for voting. Normally, we won't do politicians unless they've really had some kind of influence on society, and Birch Bayh definitely did. He was the only person to have fathered two amendments to the Constitution outside of the Founding Fathers. He fathered the 26th Amendment to the Constitution, which lowered the voting age to 18. P.F. Sloan's song had started the movement. It was patchwork across the country, and thanks to Birch Bayh, it became the law of the land. He happened to be the chairman of the Subcommittee on Constitutional Amendments, and he also fathered the 25th Amendment, which had to do with the orderly transfer of power in the event of the disability of the president. And it also provided for the president to appoint a vice president if the vice presidency was vacant. The genesis of that amendment was the assassination of John Kennedy in November 1963. Lyndon Johnson took over the presidency, but from November 1963 until Johnson's inauguration in 1965, after he won the election, the vice presidency was vacant, and Bayh's amendment provided the president could appoint someone. Appointing a vice president actually came up about a decade later when Spiro Agnew was removed from the vice presidency for malfeasance during the Watergate crisis, and Richard Nixon appointed Gerald Ford. When Nixon then had to resign because of Watergate, Ford took over the presidency, and the vice presidency was vacant again, so he appointed Nelson Rockefeller. The disability part of the amendment has been used when presidents like Reagan and Bush have undergone surgery and were under anesthesia. And when Reagan was shot, even though his chief of staff, Alexander Haig, said he was in charge, he really wasn't. The vice president, George H.W. Bush, was. One final interesting fact about Birch Bayh. In 1964, he was in a small plane crash along with Ted Kennedy. Bayh helped pull Kennedy out of the wreckage. He sort of saved his life. And the ironic thing was, 16 years later, when Kennedy ran for president against Jimmy Carter, Bayh supported Jimmy Carter, and a lot of Kennedy's people were really upset, but Kennedy said, hey, he gets a pass for this one. Bayh was also active in the Equal Rights Amendment, which didn't pass, and in the Title IX legislation, which did pass, and we talked about that when we did the Bernie Sandler podcast. So Birch Bayh is one of those politicians who definitely had an influence on American life. Well, we're going to move on to the musical segment of tonight's show with Scott Walker, who died recently at the age of 76. Not the Scott Walker who used to be governor of Wisconsin, but Scott Walker, who was the lead singer of the group The Walker Brothers. The Walker Brothers were a great group in the 60s. The only thing about them was they weren't brothers and their name wasn't Walker. Scott Walker started out as Scott Engel, and he teamed with John Mouse and Gary Leeds, and they all changed their name to Walker. They moved to California. They were good looking, they had long hair, and they had a great musical sound, but they didn't make it in California. So they did something that was basically unheard of. In the midst of the British invasion in 1964, these three guys, these Walker brothers, moved to Great Britain to try their hand at rock music. And you know what? They were a huge sensation. The British loved them so much that for a while in 1966, their fan club rivaled that of the Beatles. And the music they recorded in Great Britain, while it made a blip in the United States, was also big in Northern Europe. All this was due primarily to the great voice of Scott Walker. It's one of the legendary voices in rock music. They had three huge hits in Great Britain in 1966-67, and they were all covers. One of them was a cover of the Burt Bacharach and Hal David composition, and we've done the Hal David podcast, of Make It Easy on Yourself. Listen to the arrangement and Scott Walker's great voice.
Just tell me that we're through, and make it easy on yourself. Good
also dipped into the Four Seasons playbook with the best song that Bob Gaudio and Bob Crew, and we've done the Bob Crew podcast, ever wrote for the Four Seasons. And if you doubt me, here's Bob Gaudio to say so himself.
If you were to ask me, what's your favorite song that you've written? I'd have to say The Sun Ain't Gonna Shine Anymore.
Well, he wrote it primarily for Frankie Valli, and Frankie Valli did it. And I'm going to play it. But I have to tell you, when you listen to the Walker Brothers after that, you'll see which is the superior version.
The sun ain't gonna shine anymore. The moon ain't gonna rise in the sky. Tears are always loud in your eyes.
Hey, listen to Scott Walker out-sing Frankie Valli, and there aren't too many people who could have done this. This is a classic.
The sun ain't gonna shine anymore. The moon ain't gonna rise in the sky. The tears are always loud in your eyes. When you're with
Like I say, not too many people out-sing Frankie Valli. That was a minor hit in the United States, but a huge hit across Great Britain and Northern Europe. Their third great hit in that era was another cover of a Northern Soul song done by an African-American, Jimmy Radcliffe. This is a great song. It's almost unknown here in the United States. And I'm not sure that the Walker Brothers version is better than Jimmy Radcliffe's original, so I'll play them both and let you decide. Like I said, this is a great song. Here's Jimmy Radcliffe's version of My Ship Is Coming In.
But things are gonna be different now, baby.
Now that's a great version of a great song, but so is the Walker Brothers featuring Scott Walker's voice.
All my dreams never came true somehow, but things are gonna be different now, and baby, my ship is coming in, baby, baby.
Never figure out why that didn't make it in the United States. Anyway, Scott Walker broke off from the Walker Brothers and did some solo stuff, including a great song by Tony Hatch and Jackie Trent. We did the Jackie Trent podcast. I refer you to it. This is his 1968 Joanna.
Joanna, I can't forget the one they call Joanna. We own the summer hand in hand, Joanna, and now she's always just a tear away.
Walker Brothers broke up. They reformed for a while in the 70s, but it didn't click. Scott Walker dropped off the map for a while. He reveled in that recluse image. And when he came back in the last couple of decades cutting records, they were more avant-garde, sort of Jacques Brel type stuff. His voice was more subdued, and it was sort of popular in England, but never caught here in the United States. So he went from a teen sensation to something of an artiste. Matt Walker was a fascinating guy. Well, we're going to close tonight with our feature, Dick Dale, who died recently at the age of 81. Hey, this guy was a giant. He was the king of the surf guitar. He just about invented surf music before the Ventures and before the Beach Boys. And he had a distinctive guitar sound that you couldn't mistake anybody else's for. Dick Dale was a nice Lebanese boy born in Boston, and his family, like so many others, moved out after the war to Southern California for his father's job in the aerospace industry. He got into surfing and he got into surf music, and he combined all the influences of all the music he listened to with his Lebanese music background and he produced that distinctive sound. In 1963, he did the song Pipeline, that classic song by the Shantays we did the Brian Carman podcast to refer you to, for one of the beach movies with Annette Funicello, whose podcast we've done in Frankie Avalon. In 1987, they did Back to the Beach, and he recorded Pipeline again with Steve Ray Vaughan, and it's a killer version. Here's a little bit of it. Dick Dale tell a little of his own story, including his introduction to guitar designer Leo Fender. Leo Fender used Dick Dale as a sort of a guinea pig for his Fender Stratocaster.
Well, I wasn't a guitar player, really. I can't even read music, but I can play every instrument there is. And piano being my favorite. Harry James stuff, Louis Armstrong stuff. I love the way Harry James played. And so I always imitated him, and I did the harmonicas. And anything that came to me, sax, I learned to play the big band stuff. Became my life. Hank Williams, of course, on the guitar. Because Gene Krupa was my big hero. He was the first man to make drums a solo instrument. I developed the style of his drumming because I love drums too. So, and that's how I do that. You can hear the pulse on the one. So I'm playing drums on the guitar. So then what happened was I came to California in 1954 when I graduated in 11th grade in Quincy, Massachusetts. Then I went down to Balboa, rode my motorcycle down there, my Harley, and I had a 1941 flathead Harley. Okay, Leo Fender was like a dad, a second dad to me. And when I first met Leo, I said, hi, my name is Dick Dale. I'm a surfer, I got no money, can you help me out? And I'm playing in Balboa. He said, hey, I just made this guitar, you know, and I came out to California in 54. That's when he made the Stratocaster.
Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tepps, for his historical significance musically. Dick Dale was not a huge commercial success, but he had a revival of sorts with Quentin Tarantino's movie Pulp Fiction. Tarantino used Dick Dale's legendary surfing song at the beginning of the movie, and this is the song that all the other surf songs derive from.
It was a song called Miserlou that back in Boston, Massachusetts, on my father's side of the family, because they were born in this country, but they were of descent of from Lebanon. But I remember a song called Miserlou and a man playing on an instrument called an oud with a chicken quill. And the song Miserlou kind of went like this to start with. Like that. And the belly dancers would come out. And I goes like this.
So we're going to close with it tonight. This is Dick Dale doing Miserlou on the Ed Sullivan Show in 1963. He opens with some hokey singing surfing song, and then he breaks into Miserlou, the greatest surfing song of all time.
Now here's a youngster you read about recently in Life magazine. Here from Boston and Quincy, Mass, and now the coast, Dick Dale surfing and a swinging. So let's have a fine hand.
Thank you.